Welcome to this morning session, and today we have an illustrious speaker who is also an illustrious son of an illustrious past president, Mr. Y.M. Kale, of our institute. Mr. Kale is a chartered accountant and a member of the ICAI, and he has given me a very short profile that he has over 16 years post-qualification experience. Has been practicing in the area of transfer pricing and international taxation for past 13 years. He is a partner with BSR & Company and also worked in KPMG New York and Amsterdam office. And as I understand, he was also greatly involved in the APA is something new that has happened in India in past 1 or 2 years. But he has very extensive experience because that is what we were discussing earlier while he was in UK. With this brief introduction, I place before you Mr. Kale. Now, before I request him to start with his presentation, may I request President Mr. Yatin Shah to offer a memento. Mr. Kale, please.
A very good morning to you, fellow members, ladies and gentlemen. In today's topic, financial transactions and intragroup reimbursements, we'll mainly focus on financial transactions. And the way I've structured this presentation is that we will go through some of the basics of financial transactions. What is the difference in the concepts and benchmarking involved in financial transactions vis-a-vis other aspects of transfer pricing. We will deal with specifically with loans, guarantees, letters of comfort, some of the main controversies which are there in this area. I have tried to give as many case laws as possible in this presentation. The time may not permit us to really go through each of them. Again, by no means are the case laws that I've given, they are not by any means exhaustive. But what I've tried to do is to include all the case laws which are relevant and which really lay down the main principles involved in this area. So let me first begin with what is really the difference when we talk about financial transactions. What is it that is different? And before that, broadly, I will include three items in financial transactions. You would have loans, you would have guarantees, and you would have others. And when I say others, it could mean derivatives, it could mean any kind of hybrid products where the benchmarking principles involved will be more complex. The main difference really is that as far as financial transactions are concerned, vis-a-vis other parts of transfer pricing, you'll find that margin-based approaches are not possible. So typically your cost plus method, TNMM method will not apply. You will have to have some kind of a transactional level benchmark. So be it a comparable uncontrolled price method, or in a lot of cases, what is now permitted under Rule 10AB, the other method would be used. The availability of comparable data is typically a big challenge. Sources of data are limited. When it comes to the bond market, India does not have a very developed bond market. So getting prices in relation to financial transactions is a challenge. Then the other issue that comes up is, what is the point of reference? So when I say point of reference is, firstly, what is the time period you look at? As far as the rules are concerned, you need to take comparable data from the relevant previous year. But as far as financial transactions are concerned, there's so much volatility on a day-to-day basis that a transaction that happens in the morning may not be comparable to what happens in the evening. So again, it's very important how you define the reference data. From where do you pick up the data? Then geography can have a big role, because different countries would have different economic conditions, inflation rates would be different, currencies would have an effect. The other aspect is that there is very limited guidance. If you look at either the OECD guidelines or in fact the rules, there is absolutely nothing given by way of any guidance in terms of how to benchmark financial transactions. So this leads to some degree of subjectivity, and we will come to what kind of subjectivity as we go along. Another thing is, when you evaluate financial transactions, you need to look at who is the SSE. Is the SSE in the business of financial services, or is it a normal SSE who is engaging in some financial transactions intra-group? Because that will have an impact on the analysis. The other differentiator is the very high volumes. So especially if you're dealing with a bank, the volume of transactions is so huge that even a small variation can result in a huge transfer pricing adjustment. Having said that, the basic principles when it comes to transfer pricing remain the same. Because ultimately, you have an international transaction, you have to compute the arm's length price. That principle remains the same. These are the requirements under Rule 10b-2. It would apply in the same manner in a financial transaction, loan transaction, as it would somewhere else. So various conditions, let's say characteristics. So when you look at a financial transaction, whether it's a loan, it's a debenture, what is the size of the loan, what is the tenor of the loan, these would be the characteristics that would be required for comparability. The functional analysis. Again, what is the, who is the lender, who is the borrower, what is their relationship, what is the lending for? Is it a parent company lending to a subsidiary for some business activity? Is it a parent company lending to a special purpose vehicle for making some further downstream investments? These would be important functional characteristics to determine a financial transactions analysis. Contractual terms, whether there is a security involved, whether there is what is the tenor of the loan, these would have naturally an impact. What are the economic circumstances? The time of when is the loan being given, the timing of the loan, which is the market where the loan is being given, these would be factors which would affect the comparability. Again, as in any other method, Rule 10b-3 allows us to make adjustments for any differences between the comparable or the uncontrolled transaction and the international transaction. Adjustments can be made. Now, as we go along, we will see what are potential adjustments that are possible in this case. But I'll give you one example. Let's say there is an identical loan. All terms are identical, but the borrower is, let's say, one borrower is based in the US, the other borrower is based in India. If everything else is the same, the sovereign risk is different. So let's say US has a sovereign rating of AAA. India has a sovereign rating of BBB-. That itself would mean that in an open market, the rate of interest would vary. So this is, and again, it's something for which an adjustment is possible, because you would be able to get data for what's a BBB rate, a AAA rate, and a BBB- rate, and that kind of adjustment is possible. Increasingly, we are seeing that there is a greater focus when it comes to financial transactions. Number of factors that are really leading to that. One of the main factors being the volatility involved. And over the last 10 years, we've seen so much of volatility in the international markets, right from the dot-com bust in 2000, 2001, right up to financial crisis in 2007, 2008, Euro crisis last year. So if you just see something like a Fed rate, which all of us would be aware of, if you look at the Fed rate in 2001, that's just before the recession started, the Fed rate was 5%. Thereafter, in 2008, at the time when Lehman Brothers collapsed, the Fed rate had come to 2%. And in general, as you are all aware, that developed economies, their monetary policies have been structured in a way to really combat the recession in those countries. And that has meant there has been an increasing low interest kind of a regime. Also, if you look at some of the geopolitical factors, so if you go back 1 year, the biggest concern was the breakup of the euro. Today, that has somewhat receded. big concern last year would have been Syria. Today it would be Ukraine. But the point is that all these factors are resulting in a lot of volatility when it comes to financial markets. And this means that there is the economic crisis, and which leads to a general tightening of credit, which means that companies have to do a lot more intercompany transactions for funding. There is a lot more guarantee related transactions that have to be given. Now, when it comes to the legislature, when it comes to different governments, obviously there is a shortage of revenue, so financial transactions are one area where they are going after and trying to make a lot of adjustments. And this is really a few of the factors that have led to a significant increase in the focus on financial transactions in the past few years. Some of the key challenges that we are facing now in India is that loans, guarantees, letters of comfort, they're all being looked at, painted with the same brush, and they are generally seen to be soft targets. So if you look at the kind of adjustments which have been made over the last couple of assessment cycles, the biggest adjustments have been made in relation to share issues. In the recently completed assessment cycle, some very big adjustments have been made in derivative transactions. So again, it shows that it's a function of the subjectivity involved, and it's a function of the amounts involved, where a small variation can result in a big adjustment. And again, there has been a 2012, there was a new definition of capital financing which was introduced in as part of the international transaction in explanation to section 92B, which has retrospective application and which has created some additional confusion, which again we will come back with. Couple of recent developments, safe harbor rules and advanced pricing agreements, which again we will deal with. Advanced pricing agreements is something which today is being looked at as a way to really reduce litigation for financial transactions, because you are able to demonstrate upfront. It's much more efficient to do that rather than trying to demonstrate it after 2 years after the transaction. So now we'll start with some of the basic principles when it comes to benchmarking of loans. So these are some basic steps involved in benchmarking any loan transaction. So step one is determining the credit worthiness of the borrower, making adjustments for any specific characteristics, determining the arm's length rate of interest, and further corroborating that with some market data. So these are the broad steps which are followed in any interest rate benchmarking. So when we talk about credit worthiness, what we are seeking to do is establish a credit rating, a default credit rating for a particular borrower. So this is a rating scale which is used by S&P. So S&P, Moody's, Fitch, these are the three leading rating agencies, as we are all aware. And S&P and Moody's, the highest rating is AAA, and you go down to D. Triple B minus is what is investment grade. So anything above triple B minus is considered investment grade. Anything below triple B minus is considered junk. Similar ratings are there in Moody's as well. Their terminology is different, but for every S&P rating, there's a parallel Moody's rating. Okay. This is an example that, again, this is illustrative. The numbers may not really tie up, but I just put it for illustrative purposes. This is a methodology which is again available publicly. It is known as the Damodaran model. If you just Google it as Damodaran model, it is available on, this is Professor Ashwath Damodaran on his website. This is a model which is freely available. and it is known to be a very good predictor when it comes to credit ratings. So in my experience in the US, where we have used licensed databases for doing credit rating, and we used to back it up with a Damodaran model, many times the Damodaran model rating almost matched what was given by the licensed software. So what Damodaran model works on is primarily the interest cover ratio, EBIT divided by interest expense. That is the main ratio that it looks at. So if you look at this balance sheet, you have this company which has a loan of 200 at 12%. You've got an interest here. The interest cover ratio is EBIT, which is 150 divided by interest 24. You have a interest cover ratio of 6.25. Now, if you see the column on the right hand side, the table on the right hand side, this is the rating scale which is given in the Damodaran model. And again, you need to, there are different models for different types of companies. So be it an industrial company or a financial company, there would be different scales provided for that. So in this case, if you see interest cover ratio of 6.25, it gives you a rating of A plus. So by applying this model for this particular borrower, you are able to establish that this borrower would have a rating of A plus. And based on this, then you go on to determine what would be the rate of interest that a borrowing made by this borrower would attract. That would be the next stage. Before going into the next stage, it is also important to understand to do a stress testing of the balance sheet of the borrower to see what is the impact of the loan on the balance sheet of the borrower. So taking this example, on the left hand you have X Limited with the existing debt. So existing, we have a debt of 20, share capital 100, loan 20, and asset, total assets 120. On the right side, we are increasing that loan to 70. So we are saying that this company borrows an additional 50. Now let's see what is the impact on the different ratios. So debt equity ratio, from 2 to 10, it increases to 7 to 10. And interest cover ratio, which is 5, it drops to 1.4. So in terms of rating, by introducing a debt of 50 into this company, your rating will drop from A to B minus. Now, what is the implication of this? Is that because the rating is dropping from A to B minus, you could have a situation where this company may not be able to raise debt at that rating. So idea here is to see not only what the rating is, but also to check any additional debt that is introduced, what is going to be the impact of that debt on the rating, and whether at the lower rating the company will be in a position to raise money. So again, as I said, these numbers are not accurate. These are just given for illustrative purposes, just to bring home the concept. Please. Yes, it's true. No, so I'll tell you in a real sense what will happen is you will generally look at forecasts. You will not look at this number, you will look at forecasts. So your point is absolutely well taken, that if you have introduced debt, that would have a effect on my forecast, and to that extent there should be an increase. But as I said, this is only to drive home the concept. That's why the revenue numbers have not been changed. Sure. Yes. It will have. So again, depending on what model is being used, there is you need to factor the off balance sheet items also. So again, as I said, I've just given you a very simple illustration. Even the Damodaran model has a place to make adjustments for this. And again, so that's why even the Damodaran model is not used in isolation. You will look at other factors, as I'll come to. I'll just come to it on the next slide. So this is again something which is publicly available. This is a rating methodology which is used by Moody's. So if you go to the Moody's website, you will find their rating methodology for, again, different classes of companies. So what I've given here is for financial companies. There are non-financial factors and financial factors. And they have given some guidance in terms of, so let's say, what is the market positioning, what is the diversification, what is the level of, what is the risk positioning of the company involved, what is the quality of assets. So there are various kinds of parameters given, and based on those parameters, you need to take a subjective decision in terms of what you would grade those parameters, and on an aggregate basis, then you will come up with some rating. Now, this is inherently subjective, but then let's understand that the entire rating is a subjective science, because otherwise you wouldn't have had situations where AAA rated CDOs were basically junk. So it is a subjective exercise. Again, the department is now using a software called Risk Calc. This is a software which the department is using, but again, none of these models have really gone to court. So there aren't decisions which talk about which model is appropriate or what should or should not be used. So there is a good basis to even use things which are publicly available, like Damodaran's model or the Moody's methodology. Also, in addition to non-financial factors, there are these financial ratios, profitability, liquidity ratios, capital adequacy. These kind of ratios are prescribed. And the ultimate rating is a combination of these non-financial and financial factors. Moving on, now when it comes to benchmarking of the interest rate, these are some of the factors that are relevant: the tenure of the loan, security, size of the loan, currency involved, geographical factors. And typical sources for comparable data, so these are some of the databases which are used: Bloomberg, Thomson Reuters, Loan Connector. Again, a lot of the comparable data comes from the US market, because they have got the most developed bond market in the world, so most of the data will come from the US. Now, this is some guidance which is available in the US 482 regulations. As I mentioned to you, OECD guidelines do not really talk about anything specific on interest rates. Our rules do not have anything specific, so this is some guidance that is available, and India chapter in UN has some comments which I will come to. So these are some factors which they have, US has listed down: the credit standing of the borrower, size of the loan, duration of the loan, currency, underlying security, guarantee, and the prevailing interest rate. The India chapter in the US UN practice manual, here India has said that the Indian administration is using sophisticated methodology for pricing of intercompany loans. This is what is stated in the UN practice manual, India specific chapter. So this gives a good indication of what positions India is going to take when it comes to interest rate benchmarking. So these are the factors that they have listed down: examination of loan agreement, comparison of terms and conditions of loan agreement, determination of credit ratings of both the lender and borrower, identification of comparable third-party loan agreements, and suitable adjustments to enhance comparability. Now, one of the things that India is doing is only to look at PLR-based rates of interest. So when it comes to outbound loans, Indian company giving a loan to overseas subsidiary, Indian tax authorities will look at what is the prevailing base rate or PLR, and based on that, they will determine what is the rate of interest to be charged. And then they have also recognize that there are some challenges because of the unavailability of databases for doing this benchmarking. Now, when it comes to guarantees, the India position is that they will look at the difference in the credit rating of the guarantor and the recipient of the guarantee. They will look at the difference in the credit rating and translate that in terms of spread by looking at the respective bond rates in India. So again, the principle is that they will look at the India specific rates. That is also reflected if you look at even the safe harbor guidelines, which again I'll come to, both insofar as the safe harbors for interest rate as well as guarantees are concerned, they are both stated in terms of Indian benchmarks. These are some of the practical issues. Can I quickly run through them? The availability of data is a challenge. Even using these databases like Bloomberg and Reuters, there's a challenge in terms of getting comparability, challenge in terms of doing adjustments. Then we could have the fact that now with GAR coming in, thin capitalization, which again I will come to what is thin capitalization. Basically, if there is excessive debt, if a company has excessive debt relative to its equity, that could be reason for a recharacterization, and to that extent, deduction of interest could be denied. What is the appropriate rate of interest, whether it should be PLR or base rate, LIBOR, what it should be? Now, moving on to the concept of thin capitalization. So today, we don't have this concept under Indian transfer pricing. So basically, what it means is that a company should not have debt which is excessive to the equity of the company. So what tax authorities would do in a thin capitalization is if they find that a company has excessive debt, then the interest associated with that excessive debt, they will deny a deduction for that interest. Now, various countries follow different approaches. So they could have, some countries have a fixed ratio approach where they will prescribe a particular ratio of debt equity. So let's say 2:1 is the debt equity, then any interest in excess of that is disallowed. Certain countries would have a earnings based approach. So the maximum amount of interest would be defined as a percentage of EBITDA. Some countries like UK have an arm's length approach where they say that companies should be able to demonstrate that their debt equity ratio is arm's length relevant to the industry that is being looked at. So again, as I mentioned, the concept of thin capitalization finds mention in Chapter 10A when it comes to the general anti-avoidance rule. And one of the measures that the tax authority can do is to recharacterize debt into equity or equity into debt in case they find an impermissible avoidance arrangement. So practically what will happen is, even today, although we are not seeing it on the ground, there is a possibility, looking at the trend of adjustments and the approach of tax authorities, it is possible that they may invoke transfer pricing provisions themselves to try and disallow interest by way of thin capitalization. And the way they could do it is relying on the definition of transaction itself, which includes a arrangement or action in concert. Now, moving on to the definition of capital financing. So, as we all know, Finance Act 2012 has amended the definition of international transaction with retrospective effect, and explanation 1 to section 92B, clause C reads as follows: capital financing, including any type of long-term or short-term borrowing, lending or guarantee, purchase or sale of marketable securities, or any type of advance payments or deferred payment or receivable or any other debt arising during the course of business. Now, most of these things were, in any case, there was no doubt that a lot of these things were always covered as international transactions. There was a debate on couple of issues over here, which we will come to. But by putting in a definition which is really so wide, almost everything has been sought to be covered. And in fact, the adjustments that we are seeing in relation to share capital are also being justified. Relying upon one of the factors that they are using is to rely upon this particular explanation. Now we'll move on to some of the case laws in relation to loans. So we'll start with Perot Systems. This is one of the earliest case laws that we had on this subject. So where the issue really was whether an interest-free loan can be given. And in this case, the assessee had given an interest-free loan to its overseas subsidiary and said that this is really in the nature of quasi-equity. And they had also referred to the recipient country's laws where this had got characterized as a equity. And really, the justification was that there is commercial expediency. I'm doing it as a shareholder. My subsidiary would not have been in a position to borrow. But these arguments were not accepted, and it was held that you need to charge on an arm's length basis, and so basically there has to be an interest, and interest-free loan could not be allowed. Similar was a case in VVF Limited. This is a Mumbai tribunal decision. Similar case where the taxpayer had advanced a loan to its overseas AE. And in this case, the taxpayer did not have a borrowing. It was the loan was made out of free funds. The TPO sought to apply 14% based on an overdraft which the assessee had. The tribunal ruled that, first of all, it cannot be interest-free. Whether you have a cost of funds or not is not relevant. You need to look at some arm's length rate of interest. But they disagreed. They did not accept the TPO's 14%. In this case, the assessee itself had another borrowing, overseas borrowing from ICICI, which they looked at that rate. So in this case, Dr. Reddy's Laboratories, Here the SSE had actually charged interest at LIBOR. There were certain cases where it had charged different rates to different subsidiaries. TPO made an adjustment using 14%. Again, it was an ad hoc rate taken based on some Indian bonds. What the tribunal ruled that it was appropriate to look at the rate at which the assessee was able to deploy funds in bank deposits in India. So again, this is a different kind of a benchmark used, sort of opportunity cost that I could have, if I had not lent it to my overseas AE, I could have parked the money in a bank deposit. So that's another way to benchmark. The next case law, Shiva Industries, this is perhaps a case law which has, I would say, correctly laid down the law on this subject, and it has been followed in a number of cases. So in this case, the taxpayer had given a loan to its associated enterprise in Mauritius using LIBOR rate. The tax office sought to use PLR-based rate, and ultimately the tribunal ruled in favor of the taxpayer, saying that you need to look at what is the currency of the loan. And if the currency of the loan, if it's an overseas market, overseas currency, the appropriate rate to be used is a LIBOR, and you should not be using or looking at a domestic PLR. And this, as I mentioned, this judgment has been followed in a number of other tribunal judgments, and I would say this really lays down the correct law as far as this subject is concerned. Some of the documentation that really needs to be maintained, the agreement and any correspondence evidencing the negotiation on the rates and other terms, any benchmarking analysis that is being carried out to determine the rate of interest, Typically, quotations are taken from banks. Again, today, if you look at Rule 10AB, it would in a way be permissible to look at a quotation, because you can look at a price which is entered into or to be entered into. So a quotation to that extent could be used. So if a quotation is taken from a bank contemporaneously and kept on file, this would be a reasonably good defense. Also, what is the source of funds? If you are able to establish clearly what is the source of funds, that could be a factor. What is the end use of the funds by the borrower entity? So a lot of these factors have a role to play, and again we will see it in some of the later case laws, have a role to play in the ultimate interest rate benchmarking. So adequate documentation around these things is important. Again, these are the safe harbor rates. A loan up to 50 crores to a wholly owned subsidiary can be made at SBI base rate plus 150 basis points. This is SBI base rate as of 30th June of the relevant previous year. And likewise, if it's a loan above 50 crores, then it has to be SBI base rate plus 300 basis points. This is a safe harbor. This is something which is elective. At the time of filing the return, you need to make an election that I am availing this safe harbor, and thereafter there will be no scrutiny or no challenge from the tax authorities. Now, moving on from loans, we move on to accounts receivable. Accounts receivable has again been an area where there is a lot of litigation, a lot of controversy. And especially considering the 92B amendment of capital financing, which has introduced receivables, this is an area which is now becoming really a cause for concern. The main issue really is that what is an accounts receivable? Really, an accounts receivable is it's a result of a transaction. So you supply goods, provide services, then there's a receivable. Accounts receivable is a consequence of the main transaction. So should it really be equated to a loan transaction? And whether interest has to be charged in every case where there is an accounts receivable or not? These are some of the key issues that we will deal with. These are some of the earlier case laws: Indo-American Jewelry, Nimbus Communication, Boston Scientific. These are old cases where they basically all said that a accounts receivable, which is a debit balance as arising as a result of an international transaction, it's not a separate transaction in itself, but it's a consequence of the main international transaction. So there ought not to be any separate benchmarking. There ought not to be any interest. As far as any interest is concerned, it should only apply on commercial lending, not on these kind of transactions. This is the principle coming out of these decisions. But now this is negated because Finance Act 2012 has made this amendment, and very specifically the word receivable is introduced. Now the question that arises is whether a separate benchmarking exercise is still required. So again, I'm just sharing some thoughts here with you. That can I still argue that commercial expediency has a role over here? That there are industry specific factors. So take an industry like software, where it is very normal for customers to demand a longer credit period. There is no software company, at least to my knowledge, which charges on delayed payments from its customers. So is there a industry factor here saying that for software or for back office kind of services, there is really no justification for me, because all my competitors are giving long periods of credit? That is the industry reality. Also, there are enough and more instances where today customers are demanding what you would call vendor financing. So where they would force the vendor to give a longer period of credit. So these kind of instances are available to establish commercial expediency. Now, coming to the regulatory framework, if I look at rule 10A, transaction includes a number of closely linked transactions. So here, can you make an argument that the receivable is really intrinsically linked to the main transaction, which is the provision of services or the supply of goods? The rules would, to my mind, support that. Now, if you are using a margin-based method, and let's take TNMM as an example, I'll read out the relevant rule. The net profit margin arising in comparable uncontrolled transactions is adjusted to take into account the differences in and blah blah. Now, question is that when a transaction includes a number of closely linked transactions, can you say that the receivable can also be benchmarked under a margin-based method? And if I am using TNMM and if I am getting a margin which is higher than some comparable, then is it really necessary for me to look at that receivable separately? And I think this has not been tested, but there could be an argument to that effect. And furthermore, if you are able to make a working capital adjustment, working capital adjustment, what is it ultimately? You are just adjusting for whatever period of credit you have given extra or availed from both your debtors and creditors and equating that with the comparables. So once that adjustment is made, then is there really any further need to make an adjustment on account of these overdue receivables? Again, as I said, there is no case law around this. This is just a thought which I thought I will share with the group. Now, this is a Bombay High Court decision on this subject. Here the facts were that the assessee was not charging interest on overdue receivables, both to AEs or non-AEs. So the Bombay High Court, again, this has gone to the tribunal. Bombay High Court held that there is a complete uniformity in the actions of the taxpayer. Very clearly able to establish, I don't charge to my associated enterprises, I don't charge to my third parties. When they said, if that is the fact pattern, then you cannot force or you cannot make this adjustment. So, and this decision, this Bombay High Court decision, is after the Finance Act 2012 amendment. So although they have not specifically dealt with how the amended provision would apply, that is not discussed in the decision, but the decision is clearly delivered after the amended provisions were in place. This is a case where the Bombay High Court decision was actually slightly distinguished, the Mumbai Tribunal. Now, in this case, the maximum delay to non-AEs was only about 200 days. But as far as associated enterprises was concerned, the delay was 1200 days. So what the tribunal held is that the AE transaction and non-AE transaction is not comparable. So this means that today, let's say if I have 99% of my transactions with my related party and then I catch some one third party somewhere and just try and establish a long period of credit with that third party, that may not be acceptable. So I have to clearly show that it's part of my commercial practice not to charge to a third party, backed up by a large volume of transactions, and the delays should be similar. So in this case, they distinguished it on facts and therefore they upheld the adjustment, but they said that you give a period of 200 days, give a credit period of 200 days, anything beyond that, make the adjustment. So 200 days is what I was giving to third parties, beyond that, make an adjustment. Tech Mahindra's case, this brings out the principle that the interest rate prevailing in the debtor country is relevant. So in the facts of this case were that the assessee had charged interest at different rates to different subsidiaries around the world. The TPO picked up one of the rates which he felt was most favorable to the revenue and applied that in all cases. Now the tribunal held that ideally, so since no interest is charged to third parties, ideally nothing is chargeable, but CIT appeal had upheld he had reduced the adjustment to 2%, which was the LIBOR rate applicable in the US. So that was ultimately upheld because the assessee was not in appeal. But they did observe that if there is a, since nothing is being charged to third parties, ideally there should have been no interest imputed here. Again, couple of favorable decisions on accounts receivable. Evonik Degussa, here the principle is that the taxpayer is a zero debt company. The taxpayer is not suffering any extra cost on account of the extra period of receivables that they are giving, and therefore there should not be any adjustment made. Similarly, in the case of Lintas, in the case of third parties, they were giving third party customers were being given a period of 97 days. Again, no interest was actually being charged, although the contract specified some rate of interest. And in the related parties also there were similar delays, and they observed, like in the decision, they have observed one particular party where the delays, the period of payment ranges from 4 days right up to 496 days. So say it's a very normal commercial practice to get delayed payments, and therefore this adjustment was deleted. Now we'll move on to guarantees and letters of comfort. So again, this is just, you know, what is a guarantee and so on. I will not read through it. We will again deal with it when we are talking about case laws. So again, what is the reason why companies are today giving guarantees? So there could be reasons where a company they want to raise funds overseas without having to block the funds of the Indian companies. This would be the very normal reason why a guarantee is given. You also may need to have working capital requirements, fund your overseas subsidiaries, a very normal commercial requirement for giving a guarantee. Typically, a lot of these guarantee transactions, the Indian company would give a guarantee to a local branch of a foreign bank. In turn, the foreign bank will fund the subsidiary overseas. This is typically how a lot of the guarantee transactions would work. So factors to be considered before charging a guarantee. So whether a guarantee is implicit or explicit. So again, implicit and explicit means that merely because, let's take a group like Tata's. Let's say Tata's is a subsidiary somewhere in the world. The mere fact that the company is associated with the Tata's will give it some degree of standing, because just to maintain or protect the reputation that the Tata group enjoys, they will never allow any subsidiary to fail. So that is called an implicit guarantee. An explicit guarantee is where I actually give a formal letter to a banker saying that I undertake the obligation. If the company fails to meet its financial obligations, I will step in as a guarantor. That is an explicit guarantee. And we'll deal with a case law which looks at what is implicit guarantee and explicit guarantee. Again, why is a guarantee required? What is going to be the end use of the funds? So again, whether it's a SPV which is just making a further acquisition. So is it really whether it is really supporting the subsidiary's business, or is it something that I'm doing as a shareholder which I want in order to make an acquisition? Then other factors like debt equity ratio, amount of guarantee, foreign exchange, foreign currency risk, period and terms of guarantee. The principles involved in guarantee benchmarking are very similar to what we went through as far as loans are concerned. Now, the other issue that comes up is typically that is guarantee something that is a shareholder activity? Am I obliged to support all my subsidiaries, and therefore is it a service which is benefiting the subsidiary, or is it something that I am doing as a shareholder? This is the one typical issue that does come up. One way to look at it is that if you have a new subsidiary somewhere, on a standalone basis the subsidiary probably is not going to have any creditworthiness. Now, as a shareholder, it would be your obligation to at least bring up the subsidiary to a level where it is creditworthy. So one way to look at it is that whatever guarantee is to be given, to bring it up to a creditworthy level, so let's say in terms of credit ratings, something that pulls up the credit rating to BBB-, to my mind, could be positioned as a shareholder activity, and something beyond that is something that is giving them additional benefit. Again, a lot of these things are not tested out. It's not coming out of any decisions. These are just some basic principles that I'm sharing with you. So how to determine a guarantee fee? As I said, if it's akin to purely a shareholder activity, no fee should be attributed. So I open a new subsidiary, standalone rating would be D. I give a guarantee to bring it up to BBB- shareholder activity. If akin to services, so if I'm giving it a tangible benefit, that BBB- is going to go up to AA, then that is a tangible benefit I'm giving, and the benefit the subsidiary will enjoy is by way of a reduced rate of interest. That is the benefit that I'm giving. Now, benchmarking can be on the basis of, there is a yield approach. Yield approach is essentially what is the saving in interest that the subsidiary is able to enjoy. Or you could also have situations where you get third-party quotations. Now, the department's approach in benchmarking of guarantee fee is really to insist on an arm's length compensation regardless of the purpose for which the guarantee is given. So we have a case where a guarantee was given to, this is a reported decision, where an Indian company which was making a major acquisition had set up a SPV, I think, in the Netherlands. An Indian company had given a guarantee to enable the SPV to raise funds in Netherlands to consummate that acquisition. The TPO simply looked at the naked credit rating of that SPV, the credit rating of the holding company in India, and the difference was an adjustment, and that adjustment came to something like 10%, which incidentally was higher than the amount of interest that the SPV was paying. That's a separate issue. Again, the Indian tax authorities will look at domestic benchmarks. So they will look at whatever the difference in credit rating is, they will translate into what that would be in terms of domestic interest rates and accordingly make an adjustment. Also, we see the rates which are provided by different banks on their websites. So there are banks which say that we will give a guarantee at 3% or 4%. These kind of rates are being picked up and used in assessments. So again, as we mentioned, as we discussed earlier, the India chapter in the UN manual, India has there's an India specific chapter to the UN practice manual where India has stated that insofar as guarantee transactions are concerned, they would use the comparable uncontrolled price method, and they would look at the difference between the credit rating of the provider of the guarantee and the recipient of the guarantee, and translate that into Indian rates and calculate the guarantee fee. This is a case law, GE Capital. This is a case law which is one of the most important case laws. It's not an Indian case law, but it's very important in laying down some of the principles that are involved in guarantee benchmarking. So the facts are like this. GE Canada, it's a financial services company which is involved in financing and leasing of various products. They finance their operations by borrowing from the local capital markets. This was guaranteed by the parent company, which is GE US. And GE US started charging a guarantee fee of 1%, which was claimed by GE Canada as an expense. The Canadian Revenue Authority, CRA, they disallowed this deduction, and then this matter went into appeals. What the courts decided is that you need to look at what is the implicit support that is available as far as, so what is the benefit that is being derived as a result of the guarantee? One, the fact that GE Canada is part of the GE group gives it a certain support, gives it a certain credit rating, and then a formal letter from GE US, which is an explicit guarantee, further enhances the credit rating. So in fact, if you go to the next slide, you will see here GE Canada's credit rating without explicit support, it was significantly below the rating of GE US. So GE US is a AAA rated company, and by giving explicit support to GE Canada, it is substantially able to enhance the credit rating of GE Canada. Now, the interest saving that GE Canada gets as a result of this is 1.83%. So what the court held is that since the saving is 1.83%, it is reasonable for them to pay a guarantee fee of 1%. So the total interest saving is the maximum sort of maximum amount that of the benefit, and which would have to be shared between the two parties. Coming to some of the Indian decisions, this is one of the first decisions on guarantees, Foresoft Hyderabad Tribunal, which actually held that a corporate guarantee that is given does not fall within the scope of international transaction. Again, this decision predates Finance Act 2012. So now this decision will no longer have any application, because now post amendment, guarantee is specifically included in capital financing. Now, this is a more very recent decision which has come out in the case of Bharti Airtel. In this case, the taxpayer has issued a corporate guarantee to an Indian bank to facilitate a loan to the AE. They did not charge any guarantee commission to the associated enterprise, but the taxpayer made a suo moto adjustment of 0.65% based on some market quotes. The transfer pricing officer, based on some external CUBS, determined a guarantee fee of 4.68%. Now, the facts were like this. In this case, although this guarantee was given, the subsidiary had not actually drawn down. So there was actually no loan which was taken. So there was a guarantee in place, but the subsidiary had not actually taken any benefit. So in that particular year, there was no cost associated with this. The arguments that were being taken by the assessee is that this is really part of a shareholder activity and there ought not to be any guarantee fee charged. Now, the tribunal has made a very interesting ruling. Now, they say that in order to satisfy the explanation to 92B, so they said that ultimately the explanation that was introduced, that is subservient to 92B, and in order to meet that requirement, you need to be able to show that there is an impact on the profit, income, losses, or assets of the taxpayer. Now, in this case, the revenue has not been able to show that there is any impact on the profit, income, losses, or assets, either currently or in any future year. All that has happened is that it is contingent. There could be an impact, but it is a contingent impact. And so they have made a distinction between an impact that is as of now or in a future year and an impact that is contingent. So based on this distinction, the tribunal has held that this is not an international transaction. Now, what is not really clear is to what extent has the tribunal been influenced by the fact that the loan was ultimately not taken in this particular year. Would it have changed if they had actually taken the loan in the year? Would it have changed the tribunal's view? Second aspect that has not been dealt with is they have not gone into the fact that this could be a service. So whether or not it meets the definition of capital financing, and for capital financing, yes, profits, income, losses, assets for the year or for future years is not met. But what about a service? Merely by giving a guarantee, I am making a facility available to my subsidiary. Is it or is it not a service? This aspect has not been dealt with. And in a third party situation, there would be enough evidence available that a bank who makes available a facility to a customer, whether the customer draws down that facility or not, a certain charge will always be levied by the bank. So this aspect has not really been dealt with in this decision.
One fundamental mistake which is there in this decision.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. The fair point. Hopefully, there's no service tax person here to listen to this. In this case, Reliance Industries, the issue was whether a guarantee fee which is quoted in a website, so typically they would look at Allahabad Bank and some other banks, nationalized banks' websites and pick up some rates, whether that is valid. So in this particular case, the SSE had provided a corporate guarantee to Bank of America on the strength of which its subsidiary had taken a loan of some 80 million euros. And the department had taken some third party cup available, which was 2.5% was the cup available, based on some, it was a Dutch taxpayer. And they said that since this loan is taken in Europe, the Netherlands taxpayer is a comparable jurisdiction, and therefore 2.5% is what they used. So again, in this case, the tribunal held that there were a number of instances where the taxpayer was able to show that it had actually been charged guarantee fee by banks, where the average came to 0.38%, and they held that that should be taken as the arm's length benchmark, not something that the department has picked up somewhere out of context, which was this 2.5%. So again, these are two more decisions relating to guarantees. I'll deal with Asian Paints first. So I'll just jump a slide. So if you see in this case, the taxpayer, which is Asian Paints, has provided a guarantee to a bank, which is a India branch of a foreign bank. Sorry, it's an Indian bank. And they have paid commission of 0.25 to 0.35%. Based on that, the foreign branch of this bank has provided a loan to the associated enterprise. And the taxpayer, the Asian Paints, has charged the associated enterprise. So whatever they have paid to this bank, which is 0.25 to 0.35, they've recovered that. Plus, they have added a markup of 20 basis points. So they have charged the subsidiary whatever they have paid to the bank plus a particular markup. Now, what the department has taken, TPO has applied 3% as a rate, which again he has picked up from various websites. What the tribunal has held is that the recovery of what the SSE has paid to a third party bank plus a markup is reasonable, because effectively it's giving him more than 50% markup on what his cost is. And what the department has done, which is to pick up this 3% from some website, is inappropriate. Similar kind of a view has been taken in Everest Canto, where again the SSE has an arrangement where they had taken a facility from ICICI Bank at 0.6% and they had charged their subsidiary 0.5%. So again, department has said that that internal cup, and they, although there is a small difference there, they said that that should be okay considering the difference in the size of the guarantees. That internal cup was accepted and they have not agreed to the TPOs using this external 3% data. In Glenmark's case, the main, so again in this case, the taxpayer had charged guarantee commission of 0.53% for a loan and 1.47% for a letter of credit. The TPO has taken 3% as arm's length. Now, they have relied, the tribunal has relied or discussed the decisions of the earlier decisions, Asian Paints, Everest Canto, Reliance, and observed that in all those cases, these 3% rates have been rejected and they have followed the same decision. And they have also agreed with the assessee's contention that there is an inherent difference between a bank guarantee and a corporate guarantee. Because a bank is in the business of giving guarantees. Corporate guarantee is essentially something which is internal. It's an internal activity. To that extent, some adjustments should be made. This is what they have observed. And they have ruled in favor of the assessee. Now, very quickly, this is another issue that keeps coming up, which is a letter of comfort. So, lot many times the transfer pricing officers are simply extending the same logic of a guarantee to a letter of comfort. Now, the critical thing then becomes is, what should be the appropriate wording of a letter of comfort? In certain cases, the letter could be saying nothing more than the expressing an awareness of the fact that the subsidiary has taken on a certain borrowing. It could be as simple as that. But the wording of the letter of comfort is very important. And under the relevant civil law of the country where this letter has been given, does the parent company have any liability under the civil law of that country? That is an important factor that needs to be dealt with. But as far as the department is concerned, it is very clearly taking a view that even a letter of comfort is akin to a guarantee and therefore there ought to be some charge for it. Perhaps the decision that Delhi Tribunal decision of Bharti Airtel that we went through, that perhaps could have some favorable impact over here. So again, the benchmarking and documentation for a guarantee transaction. Again, as I mentioned, the approach should be very similar to what a loan transaction is. You look at the credit rating of the borrower entity, the benchmarking analysis, quotations from third-party bankers, internal documentation, internal transfer pricing policies, and finally, what is the cost saving involved and how it is, what proportion of the cost saving is really needs to get charged out. Again, safe harbors are there for guarantees as well. Guarantee up to 100 crores, you have safe harbor rate of 2%, and guarantee above 100 crores to it's a rate of 1.75%, provided the credit rating of the associated enterprise is done by a credit rating agency which is recognized by SEBI and the credit rating is of the highest quality. These are conditions which are prescribed under the safe harbor rules. Now, this is a very topical controversy and in fact has led to some of the largest disputes that we are seeing in the last couple of years. So, very simple, you have a foreign company. Sure.
Most of the company where they have provided guarantee to the overseas enterprise, even their own credit rating goes down. So that whether there would be reverse adjustment for this, like company which is providing guarantee for its overseas enterprise, their own rating comes down because of disproportionate guarantee. It's the same thing has happened like Tata Chorus itself.
Right, I agree.
So what would be the impact like in this particular transfer pricing case for this?
Okay. So, as far as one aspect is that how do you value this transaction? Do you value it by way of the benefit that you have provided, or do you value it? So it's like take a loan transaction. Do I value it based on what is my cost of funds, or do I calculate the interest based on what that loan transaction is and what the comparable loan transactions to that are? Now, taking your example, I see where you're coming from, that yes, by giving that guarantee, you're also impairing your own borrowing capacity, and which would mean that there is a higher cost of borrowing as far as the Indian entity is concerned. That I do understand. But I would still say that as far as the pricing of the guarantee is concerned, you would really have to look at what is the benefit that you are giving the subsidiary. Because somewhere you are also providing the guarantee, you're not in the business of providing a guarantee. You're providing a guarantee because you are in the position of a parent company and you have an interest as a shareholder in your subsidiary. So to that extent, your credit rating, in any case, also you'll have to see that this is your standalone credit rating. If you look at it overall, in any case, the subsidiary is consolidated within you. So I would say that you need to look at what is the benefit that you're giving to the subsidiary for this kind of a charge. And again, what is the impact on the parent company? That is a separate issue that will need to be seen.
Or above 100 crore, it is 1.75% or more. So this or more means what?
Anything. If you choose to pay 3% and pay tax on that, they are not going to stop.
But 2% is sufficient. Or more means assessing authority can say or more means.
No. That's a minimum. That's a minimum. So you meet the 2%, they're okay.
Okay. Right.
So they are not saying you can't do more. So infusion of share capital, you have a foreign company infusing shares, so Indian company is issuing shares to its parent. Lot many cases you've had a situation where even in a case where 100% parent is infusing shares, tax authority has said that you should have done a fair valuation of the shares, and huge adjustments are being made on this for this reason. So if you see the last two cycles of transfer pricing assessments, some of the large names, like you have Vodafone, you have Shell, and a lot of these matters are now coming up. I think 15th April is when the matter is scheduled for hearing in the Bombay High Court. Adjustments are huge, and Shell India is 15,000 crores, Vodafone 1,300 crores, and there are a number of other taxpayers also who have been affected. Essentially, the dispute is whether you should have done a DCF for while issuing the shares. The argument from the taxpayer's perspective is ultimately this is I am issuing shares to my parent company. There is no value shift of any sort. And also it is a issue of shares. Even if you make an adjustment, if you say that I should have issued not at 100 but at 200, the difference should ideally be share premium, which should be a capital receipt. And that is being sought to tax by the revenue. And they are also saying that whatever shortfall that you had, you should have issued at 200, the shortfall they are treating as a loan which India is giving to its parent company and charging interest on that. So this is a issue that is last 2 years has created a lot of litigation. So very quickly, this is a case law which basically says this is a taxpayer which had sold shares in a domestic company to the associated enterprise, and the valuation was done based on the erstwhile CCI guidelines. The revenue's position was that you should use DCF, and ultimately that is what has been upheld by the tribunal, that DCF is the more appropriate method for this transaction, and you need to follow DCF. Again, that's the same thing that is being, that's the same position that is being taken in the share issue controversy. So moving on to intra-group services and reimbursements, and just very quickly, I think I'm conscious of the time. So again, intra-group services, they are inherent for any multinational group that's operating. You will have various kinds of services which are undertaken centrally, and there will have to be some mechanism based on which the services get charged out to different subsidiaries. From a charging out perspective, what is generally looked at is, are the services such as are benefiting the recipient, or are they something that are really duplicating an activity which is already being carried out by the service recipient? This is the main principle. So if it's a service that is beneficial, and if it's a service that would have ordinarily been paid for in a third party situation, then it is appropriate to charge out for that service. If it is really non-beneficial, or if it is some service that I'm carrying out purely as a shareholder, then there is inadequate justification to charge out. So let me give an example. So let's say there is some audit that has to be done only to meet with the regulatory requirements of the country of the parent. So let's say US has Sarbanes-Oxley, and there is something to be done only for Sarbanes-Oxley, which is purely a US-based regulation. That cost may not be appropriate to be charged out, but that would be more in the nature of a shareholder activity. Or if there is some financial restatement that is to be done only to meet the GAAP requirements of the parent company's reporting framework, then again it would be something which is more like a shareholder activity. But again, these are some of the items that are listed. These are typically activities that do get charged out. And generally, multinationals will have some basis on which they will charge out, because a lot of the overseas jurisdictions, so I can give you the example of the US, which has services regulations which lay down requirements for companies that they have to charge out. They have to look at what are the headquarter services that they are rendering, and they are required to charge them out to their subsidiaries. Otherwise, they have a risk of disallowance. So again, finally, the key here is the documentation, and really the ability of the recipient to show that they are benefiting from the services. The main challenge, and again, which I've just given two case laws over there, the main challenge that we have in this area is to be able to show that the services have been delivered, and what is the benefit that the Indian entity, which is the service recipient, has derived from the services. This is really the main challenge, and the documentation around it. This is GEMPLUS. Again, GEMPLUS was a Bangalore tribunal decision. Again, this was a case where there was a certain apportionment methodology, certain charges were levied onto India, and the assessee was not able to demonstrate that it had benefited from the services. So on that basis, there was a disallowance. So just to give you an example, they gave one observation in the order is that the parent company has charged for certain trainings, and that training translated into X number. The revenue has observed that you could have sent a person to IIM Ahmedabad for the same amount. So what was the need for you to have paid your parent company for this training? So things like this come out. So I think that the idea is to really be able to strengthen the documentation and be able to demonstrate what was the need for the service and what was the service, how it benefited the business. This actually comes out very well in this decision of McCann Erickson, where the assessee was able to demonstrate in a very convincing manner, and in fact this is a decision that if you go through that decision, it actually brings out very clearly how they have gone about documenting it, where they have shown that, okay, how was the service delivered? Was it by way of a visit? Was it by way of an email? Was it by way of an access to some portal? What was the benefit to India? So let's say they've given a roster of the clients that this McCann Erickson has. And they said, I could not have possibly had this roster of clients if I did not have access to all those people in the US. or I needed to have technical expertise in these particular fields, which is not available with me, which was available with my parent. And for each category or six or seven categories of services that were there in this, they were able to demonstrate through adequate documentation that they actually had received these different categories of service. So again, as I said, here the key is documentation and being able to demonstrate benefits. That brings me to an end. I think I've finished in time and happy to take any questions.
Still, department based on that GE Canada decision is making the adjustment. So, if we are able to get a certificate from the bank that this is only a procedural requirement, it will not affect the rate of interest. Will it be a very concrete something which you can rely?
When you say procedural requirement, is the bank going to say that even without that I would have lent?
Yes, it would have lent. It would not have changed the rate of interest.
But again, it would be very fact specific because it will be so. Then. The argument will be that yes, they would have lent because you are a subsidiary. So that implicit guarantee is already factored in. That's what would happen. So it'll be very, so what you're saying, conceptually I see what you're saying, but it'll be very difficult to demonstrate, that is what I feel.
Loan and a corporate guarantee. Do you say this would then went out to be at arm's length?
See, joint ventures can tend to be a little complicated because you may have some shareholders' agreements. In a joint venture situation, again, need to be mindful of the fact that there is no differentiation when it comes to joint ventures. The test is, are you an associated enterprise or are you not an associated enterprise? So if you cross the 26% threshold, you will become an associated enterprise and the other consequences will follow. The question is that if you have some prior arrangement as shareholders, then can you say that that is determinative of an arm's length behavior? There could be, again, it will have to be very case specific, but there is always a risk that you could trigger provisions such as 92B2, you could trigger 92F, which defines transaction in a very broad manner, arrangement, action in concert. So again, it will be very fact specific what you're saying. I would not say in a general sense that in every joint venture situation, you can be out of the rigor of this.
Judgments are near to the bank rate of 0.25% to 0.5%. You feel this should be a logical way to look at it, or because after this new rates that they have come up in terms of safe harbors?
See, I think so. As far as safe harbor is concerned, I think you have to appreciate that safe harbor does not mean arm's length. In fact, the revenue has gone so far as to say that safe harbor is a convenience pricing. This is a statement made by Kamlesh Varshney. Now, what will be the influence of those rates, whether it will have an influence on the courts, only time will tell. But going by the decisions, and again, the guarantee, it will be something which is very fact specific. So again, just because some decisions have okayed 0.35% or 0.4%, whether that will apply as a general rule, one doesn't know. If you look at other industries, there are a number of decisions where assessee with a cost plus 7 or 7.5% has got relief at a tribunal level. Can we make a general statement saying that all cases which are 7 or 8% will get relief at tribunal? Perhaps not. So very again fact specific. We'll have to see case by case. But I can tell you that as far as the safe harbor norms are concerned, those should not have an influence, negative influence as far as the future court decisions are concerned. That I don't think will be the case. The revenue will continue to do what it's doing at an assessment stage. That we don't have control over. Okay. Thank you. So if there's anything else, please feel free to mail me.
Thank you, Mr. Kale, for sharing your knowledge and experience. Now, Namrata, can you please?
It gives me immense pleasure to thank Mr. Vaman Kale for the comprehensive coverage of the subject that he has done in terms of various types of financial transactions that we experience and the hurdles we face in benchmarking the same. And I'm sure we would all agree that he has not kept his knowledge and experience implicit, but has explicitly expressed everything that he could give to this audience. For that, I request all of you to propose a hearty vote of thanks. Thank you, sir. We break for tea for about 15 minutes and gather, assemble back for the next session. Thank you.